This is how we do it. It's Friday night, and I'm losing my skivvies. Oh, coffee.
Oh, coffee, 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 coffee.
Shit.
God, that just makes me want to get up in the club.
You guys know this man? It's how we do it.
What movie does that remind you of?
Freaking,
Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on.
Nutty Professor.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
The comedy scene. This is how we do it. It's Friday night.
I just watched the clip of that when Buddy Love is,
you know what?
Flip the table on Reggie.
You know what I just thought about? Buddy Love needs to be a buck name.
For sure.
Abso-fucking-lutely. Absolutely. Let's talk about buck names, actually. This is just kind of a BS session that Dino and I are going through, but before we get started, this is Goose Chasing. Y'all know where you're at. You're listening. You know where you're at.
You came here.
You came here for us, and we appreciate that. This is Goose Chasing, brought to you by Tag and Brag, Tag and Brag Productions, Tag and Brag Apparel, Tag and Brag Land Management. If you want a better hunting plan, land management plan, build it with us together. All right, buck names. Let's fucking go. Buck names are, there's an art, in my opinion. In my opinion, there's an art to buck names. Don't be a dumbass and name your bucks like, you got to use the characteristics of the rack, I think. Or that should, or maybe it's like a personality thing, whatever. You could use the characteristics of the rack, but you can't say what you see. Like, the, like, wide glide. I mean, that's the fucking dumbest name ever. Or,
but you can't, I mean, let's just be real. We've done this.
Well, yeah, we have done it. We're subject to it. We're not perfect.
But the thing is, when you're running trail cameras, you have a lot of bucks on camera, whatever, and if you're hunting a property where your other buddies are hunting, you're trying to reference a certain buck. Sometimes you're not like in the naming
fully locked in.
Well, you're not in like the naming stage yet. Like, you know, you just put the cameras out, whatever. Right. And that's how you reference your bucks. It's like, oh, well, that split G2 buck. That's like just how you do it.
Right.
It hasn't. So most people don't get to the naming point.
Okay, so maybe that's what's happening.
Or they just don't discipline themselves or commit to going to that point.
It is an art and it is a discipline. And YouTube hates naming bucks. You name a buck on YouTube, you shoot them. You might as well fucking just get ready for the comments to light up with bullshit.
Like, oh my god, you shot your pet.
You name your deer.
Grow your deer. Oh, high five.
Are you in a deer farm?
Come on, people. Freaking
kiss my ass.
Be in some more bad moods.
Yeah, have some fucking fun.
My goodness.
Hey, why don't you loosen the G string from your ass crack?
Yeah, get a bigger size. I mean, Jesus. Freaking A. It's like that thing's got like a freaking ratchet strap on the hips and you're just cranking the shit out of it.
It's got a ratchet strap on the hips and it's got a ratchet strap on the girdle. Like you are tightening up the old satchel.
Gosh, dang it. The thing's going up that crack. It's like one of those freaking wire cheese cutters. Have you ever seen one of those things? Just like slicing your anus. My God, loosen. Less pucker, folks.
Give me a cracker for that shaved provolone.
Less pucker, folks. Life is short.
Oh,
my
man.
Goodness. Like, God forbid anybody throws some fun into hunting.
Yeah,
holy shit. You know, or inventorying their deer herd. God forbid, you know, we should be shunned for it.
I mean, the deer management and the land management portion of, like, hunting now is a thing. I mean, there's a lot more. That's why hunting land is so hard to come by because the people that have a grasp on private land, or a lot of people that have a grasp on private land, they want to put work into it. They want to make their habitat better to make their hunting better. And so with that, you are going to keep tabs on the herd that runs through your property naturally.
Yeah. And a lot of, I mean, how many different characteristics can bucks have? I know they do, but like a lot of them are 8 points. A lot of them are 10 points, you know, like
short time, 10.
You can only, when you watch enough bucks and you have enough cameras out, like you almost have to name them. Otherwise you're going to be like texting each other while you're in the woods. Like, oh, I just saw that short time 10 with the little split coming off his friggin' G1 and he's got a white hoof. It's like, no, we don't want to say all that. We just want to say, hey, that's Lloyd. You know?
His buddy Harry was right behind him.
But it does cause some problems because, you know, sometimes it doesn't cause problems, but you know, if you're gonna name your deer, everyone in camp's gotta know the names.
The name,
because then you start texting in the group like, oh, I saw Lloyd, and then everyone's like who's, dad's like, who's Lloyd? The hell's Lloyd?
And then you got to go through the Rolodex of Moultrie mobile photos. You got to find a photo or a video, and then you got to send it in the group chat. And by that time, Lloyd's already circling his honey back around. He's grunting her right to the tree. You got your hand on your phone, and you don't even know what to do because your camera's over to your right. Your bow's hanging God knows where. Your grunt call's like flopping over your shoulder, and you're in a mess. You're in a pickle at that point.
You are in a pickle.
I mean, it really just, when you name your bucks, it gives you a better chance of shooting them. We've actually said that before, and it has proved to work.
Yeah, like we've hunted a buck all year where we were just like, oh, that's the 10.
Didn't see him.
And then never we're like, well, we're not going to see him until we name him. Now we name him, and at least you see him.
Lo and behold.
What are you drinking this morning?
Javi, black Javi, baby. Although it's a it's a weak batch, I must say.
A little weak batch?
I feel like I'm drinking hot water right now.
A little weak bean in that batch?
I think there was too much filter. I put a little too much filter in there. I might have doubled up. There might have been two filters stuck together. I hate when that happens.
Oh man, naming bucks. It's
what's one of your favorite buck names that we've had?
Favorite buck
or name. Just some of your favorites. Like you just let them rip, because I mean we'll start telling stories about any and all of them. The Godfather, obviously, that was legendary. I mean, what a name. And what I mean, it fit him perfectly. Like the Godfather got his name because he was a legendary buck on the hill, not just from us, from a lot of people, a lot of neighbors, a lot of people that were like miles down the road. They knew this deer. He was 8 or 9 years old in Western New York. That's like Guinness Book of World Record type shit.
It's funny too, because some people in our area, they'll like watch our videos and then they start calling the buck what we call the buck. And that's even better. That's awesome.
That's great.
I had people
create community.
It's funny you mentioned that. I actually had three guys. They came into Hogan's yesterday and they're like, hey, like, hey, you look just like this kid I watch on YouTube. And I'm like, what kind of videos? And they're like, hunting videos. I'm like, it could be me.
I'm that child.
And he's like, why is the name drawing a blank right now? And I'm like, is it tagging Brad? He's like, oh my God, yeah. I'm like, yeah, it's me. And he started naming all of the bucks. He's like, dude, we watch all your videos. Then there was a guy over in the deli. He came like running in. He's like, oh my God. He's like, dude, Sventech and The Godfather are some of the best videos we've ever watched. So it's that was literally yesterday. It's funny that you say that. But they reference it that way. Like if we didn't name, I don't know. I feel like it creates a different
dimension
to the hunt.
For our experience, you know, when you hunt bucks like that year after year and you start to build a story with them, and for like how we put out our content on a semi-live basis, the viewers do get to like experience and learn the deer with you. So yeah, they do reference them. And that's honestly, that's one of the coolest parts about how we've kind of changed up our format of putting out content and just really like letting it all hang out. I mean, it's bit us, you know, from time to time with people following along, like literally following us to hunt where or in and around where we're hunting because we put so much stuff out there. But when it comes to that portion of it where it's like kind of a sense of community where it's like, it's almost like you're watching a sports team and it's like, yeah, you got the Godfather, you got Sventek, you got Nipsey, you got Neil, you got, you know, like they all, people know these deer, and that's a cool aspect of it for sure.
Yeah, I think it creates more of a following point, honestly. If that makes sense.
A reason. Yeah.
Yeah, it gives the viewer more of a connection and just more of a story. And I think it's cool. I think it's fun. Like I said, like we talked about at the beginning, a lot of people are like, I don't know what they think or why they think it is like a problem.
Those are just, unfortunately, those are just, they're people that are, they either have insecurities or they're going through some sort of pain and they're trying to inflict it on somebody else. Because there's really nothing bad or there's nothing negative about that at all. There just isn't. Like, you can say, oh, I only name my pets, or oh, I only, you know, it, but that's just digging. You're just digging for bullshit at that point. I'm sorry. Yeah. You just are. So,
let me give you a shovel.
Yeah. But getting back to like, to the Godfather, that name was so fitting because we coined him the Godfather literally years before we got him, because he was the buck that couldn't be killed. He was the head honcho. He was like the king of the mafia. That was the Godfather.
The funny thing is, we didn't even really, he was just one of those lurking ghost bucks to us.
Right.
I mean, he didn't live, he was not a deer we watched like through the summer, really not even. One year we watched them for a month in the rut. But other than that, like, he wasn't a deer we watched. We just knew of him, and it was so, like, almost spooky, mysterious.
Yeah, exactly.
That's kind of why he got his name. But
remember his counterpart, the year that he was pretty, the year that he was on our property quite a bit, his counterpart was a fat, I mean, massive 8-point frame, and we had never seen the deer before that year, but he, for whatever reason, at least in October when the Godfather was around, he was always like lurking with him, and we nicknamed him Uncle Tony. And yep, that was another great name. Unfortunately, we never got to run into Uncle Tony.
No, I think we only had 1 year of Uncle Tony.
Yeah. That was a big deer too. He had a friggin' massive body on him. Dang. I mean, that had to be a 5+ year old deer, like at that time too.
Oh yeah. He definitely was.
I mean, the Godfather was running around at like 6 or 7 and he was following in, like, literally we had two, you know, 5+ year old deer on the property at the same time. Like, that really doesn't ever happen.
Ever. Really doesn't happen much of ever.
All right, come on. Now I need some of your favorites.
I'm trying to think, like, New York. I love Peter North.
Peter North in Ohio. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm thinking of just all bucks.
Peter North, we got some Bucks that are still alive. We got Peter North. We got Ron Jeremy. That's a great one. I mean, Peter Griffin was that was just hilarious.
Peter Griffin was great.
Great Buck. Great name. Great comparison to Peter Griffin.
Yeah.
On Family Guy.
Yeah.
Slew Bega was a great one. That was probably, honestly, Slew Bega was probably one of my favorite. My favorite Buck names. And it was because, and Slew Bega, Slew Bega came about because when he was younger, he lived, or what we thought, we kind of had him dialed in to living in like one or two little sloughs in up in North Dakota, and God bless you.
Shit.
Gazoon tight.
Allergies on fleek.
Oh, allergies are
my God,
flying out the window.
4 days have been popping through the roof.
You got to get that Zyrtec up in your system, boy.
I got it.
It's an off-brand,
but I got it.
Them off-brands, you know, they can be. That's a risk. That's all I'm going to say. It's a risk.
They're the same. Just read the back label. They're freaking not twice. They're literally eight times the price, and they're the same.
This boy's reading label bags and shit. Anyway, Slew Bega.
Just a smart consumer.
Slew Bega was sanctioned, or he lived in these couple little sloughs, or that's what we thought. And I don't... We just, like... He was a slew buck, like he was the slew. So we were like slew what?
Lou. I don't remember if maybe Mambo Number 5 came on or something while we were in the lodge and doing some nighttime, you know, cooking or something. And then we were like,
Slew Bega,
friggin' Slew Bega.
That's good. That's rich. That is rich. One. A two, a three, four, five. Everybody who
that's when the naming five. Gets. That's when the name gets fun. Like fun though is when the trail of meaning extends beyond like two or three different things. You know, like
you got to really explain it.
Yeah,
but it actually makes perfect sense.
Yeah, like it goes from one characteristic to okay, well. These people have that characteristic to, you know, it goes to the next thing. It's like a trail, a rabbit hole. Sometimes we're like, I don't even know how we got there.
Yeah, we got to like check ourselves at times and be like, why did we name this? What were we thinking?
What the hell were we thinking?
Another one, great one is Dwight. I mean, the biggest 6 point you'll ever see.
Yeah.
Dwight was a man. He got his nickname because at that time, and once again, referencing this because we're both basketball fans, but at that time, LeBron was on the Cavs. Dwight Howard was on the Orlando Magic. He was a nemesis of the Magic. The Cavaliers because they were good.
They were great. That team was good.
They were good. Turkaloo.
What the hell happened to that guy?
I know. I mean,
he was unstoppable against the Cavs, and it was just like 2 years, and then boop.
See ya. He got paid, and then he disappeared.
And they had Rashard Lewis, that like 6'10 dude that just stroked threes.
And then who was their little guard?
Nelson.
What was his name?
Last name was Nelson. Jameer Nelson. Nelson.
Yeah. He kind of faded out pretty quick, too, after their one- or two-year run.
Small dude, but they had, I think it was like Michael Pierce. They had just a couple role players that were good.
Yeah. But anyway, Dwight Howard, massive, wide shoulders, just a gargantuan of a human. And that's what Dwight was. Dwight was a massive 6 point, widest buck you'll ever see. Just massive wide frame. But then there was not much going on with his rack. He was a 6 point, you know? So it's kind of like Dwight, you know? Big old human.
He just had a frame that you dream of.
Yeah. I mean, if he was
a frame that you dream of. I mean,
if he was a 10 point, he would have been well into the 180s.
You don't see bigger frames than that. And that, you know, from the naked eye, that's what makes Box look absolutely ginormous, is when the frame is huge. And that's exactly what he had.
You are right.
I mean, 20, I think his inside spread, I have to remember, I'm pretty sure it's 23 inches.
Yeah, that's inside.
Inside spread, 23 inches, and his G2s are both over 12, I believe.
Yeah, legitimately.
Yeah, legitimately. Most people say that. Like,
he had 15-inch G2s.
When a deer has a 10-inch tine, it's huge. Like, a 10-inch tine is huge.
Yeah. And,
you know, most people throw those numbers around. Like, I'm talking from the top of the rail, from the top of the main beam, to the top of the point, 10 inches. This, he had, I think one is 13, and I think the other one's 12.
Yeah, I think the one is like
a touch of 13.
Low 13s, yeah.
But those two, 23 inches inside, that's just nuts. But that was it. That was what he had. There was no like 6-inch brow tine. That was it. That was all you get.
That's all you get. Two big tines and a massive frame.
That's all we got with Dwight Howard, too. A handful of years of greatness, and then...
See you later.
Bitcheroni.
He faded into the darkness. Have you ever watched the show Special Forces?
No.
Dude, you got to watch it. It's awesome. It's like, I think it starts with like 20 celebrities, and they go through a 10-day, basically like a 10-day course of literal special forces drills and scenarios and all this shit. Like, they're jumping out of helicopters into the water, and they got to like swim to a buoy and then dive. And they get dropped into the water in a car strapped in a seatbelt. And then they have to go down like 30 seconds, and they have to keep themselves calm, get themselves out of the seatbelt, swim through the back window of this car, and then, you know, get up to safety. Like, they put them through all of these crazy scenarios. But one of the celebrities is Dwight Howard. And when I watched the whole series, I think it's on Netflix. Maybe it's Amazon. I can't remember. But when you watch that whole series, you do gain a different respect for Dwight Howard, because this shit is insane. This shit is insane that they put him through. And like, they don't have to necessarily pass the mission, but to like keep moving on, but they do get like graded on every mission. And then, you know, people quit. Like, they're dropping like flies, like within the first day.
I think like, the car thing in the water would probably knock me out of the comp.
Yeah, that was nuts. I mean, almost every scenario had something to do with heights. Like, the one they...
So you'd be good at this.
Oh, dude, it was insane. The one they had this like tightrope walking across this canyon, and it was probably like, I don't know, 150 or 200 feet across. And they had to, I mean, they were strapped on, but they had to hold on to these two like cables on each side. And then they had to tightrope this whole fucking way across this canyon. And in the middle, they had like a couple obstacles that they had to get over on the tightrope and keep going. And if they fell, they free fell for like, I don't know, like 30 feet. And then their harness like caught them or whatever, and it lowered them to the ground. But they had to be 300 feet up in the air for this thing.
Hell no.
And it was nuts. But anyway, getting on the Dwight Howard topic, that would give you another newfound respect for the big fella.
Well, gosh damn, Dwight. Sorry for talking shit. You know, I just sometimes I'm so passionate about the game of basketball that when you see a specimen of that size, I shouldn't say that because the dude dominated for so long. Like he dominated the Cavs. He just dominated. It's not as common for giant men to dominate the sport of basketball for like 20 straight years. So yeah. I don't know how long he did it for, but it was probably long. It was long enough. And he's still, is he a Hall of Famer or not yet? He probably will be.
Not yet, no.
I know he didn't win a championship, but did he? No, he didn't.
Kobe hated his ass.
Yeah, I mean, his run was with the Magic.
Yeah.
He was one of those players that tried to do a bunch after that, and it just didn't, it didn't pan out. I think there was a little bit, I don't know. You got to just be hungry in the NBA. That's what it comes down to, and there's so much money and stuff involved that it probably is easy to let that be a big distraction and a motivator or whatever you want to call it.
For sure.
A priority, but shit, you got to be hungry.
I mean, think about the business that we're in. When you start getting money involved, it starts to get like that a little bit. You think about things a little bit differently. I don't know. Not from like a hunting perspective, but now all of a sudden you got to promote and you got to, you know, certain amount of posts and videos created and yada, 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 yada. And you got people down your friggin' neck going, well, you didn't give me this video. You didn't do it. Hey, why don't you post some of our shit? How about that?
How come you didn't do this for us?
How come this part of the contract was null and void? Can you explain that?
Oh man, the Cavs look good two nights ago.
They did. I mean, obviously, when this podcast comes out, we'll have two more games under the belt. But
I forgot about that. It's almost pointless to talk about it. But
no, but they did look good. There was a different team, different squad.
They're going to have to really, really hone in tonight.
Yes, they will. And I think they will. I think we're going to win tonight, personally.
Shit. Might have a Donovan Mitchell 35+.
Yeah.
We're going to need it tonight, I think.
Him and Garland's going to have to keep rolling.
Yeah.
And
LeVert, man, he's got to do his thing.
Yeah, I don't know if we're going to be getting 24 or 26 out of them every single game, but
we don't need to, but you got to get 15.
Yeah, you got to get 15.
Game one, he went 1-for-7. 1-for-7, I think he had 3 points or 2 points.
Yeah, that's not.
Can't do that.
No.
But the difference, again, just, I'm sorry, I am an Isaac Okoro fan, but there's just times for him.
Yeah.
And I'm sorry.
Regular season.
Yeah. But this series, I just don't think is for him. You need offensive threat on the floor.
You can't. It's tough to be a one-sided player once the playoffs start. Like you have to have at least a little bit of a threat on
because
the other side of the ball.
Especially the way Donovan and Garland play, you can't. Like they're gonna be driving, and the move is a kickout.
Yep.
And you can't be a defensive player sitting on the baseline in the corner three, camped out there wide open, and you just can't knock that shot down. That's why it drives me crazy that they play Osman so much, because he can't knock that three down. He will.
Sometimes he will.
He will, but it's not a high enough percentage to. That's why you have to play Danny Green, which they did, and he didn't take enough shots. He actually passed a few up, and he did knock down one shot where his heel was on the baseline, out of bounds.
But he did knock down one shot that kind of stopped the run from them too, which was a big
shot. Big three, but it's just his defense and size and presence alone that he can knock down that three is a huge.
That's why bailing on Kevin Love, man, it fucking.
Oh, he'd be stroking three balls right now.
That's his offensive game, and then he can rebound on the other side. And like, what's scary for us is the fact that outside of Jared Allen and Evan Mobley, there's no big man to come in. There's nothing.
There is. He won't do it. Freaking Lamar Stevens, dude, is the dog.
I know that, but naturally Lamar Stevens is a small forward. I mean, naturally,
yeah, but size wise, but it doesn't matter because I go back to it. Heart. This is where hungriness is all that matters. I don't even care if you're 6'4". If you're hungry, you'll do it. And that dude has a motor, and he will dog people. Like, he will freaking bully people. That's what he did all season. When towards the end of the season, when we went on like a 4-5 game losing streak, I believe Lamar Stevens, it wasn't even like he got 40 minutes to play, but he was part of the reason that changed that
losing streak.
Well, just that, the momentum shift, the energy of the team.
I feel it.
Because, like, getting rebounds and shit, I don't care if you're 6 foot, put a body on someone and drive them backwards. You can get rebounds.
Yeah.
And he's a big, I don't know how tall Lamar Stevens is, but he's a big dude, like strong dude.
I agree with you.
He's a bully down there. I'd love to see him in the game a little bit. You know, if Mobley and Allen are doing their thing and they're dominating, I get it. You can only have so many people in the rotation, but if you get a little bit of, if you get them in foul trouble or something, they have to put that dude in the game.
Yeah.
I think they'll be like, holy shit, this dude is a beast. Because he is. Bless you. Allergies. Oh. Get some of that off-brand Zyrtec.
Get that off-brand in your system, boy. Get it
Costco.
In there.
Dude.
Tell me about Costco. Tell me about how much you fucking love Costco.
I love Costco, and I freaking hate it. Because you can't go there without spending $200. I mean, it's like almost impossible.
Yeah. You're going to fill your cart.
It's not even filling the cart, dude. Every item is average $10. So if you have 10 items, you're at 100 right there. So,
right, but you fill your cart, you're good for the apocalypse. So,
not to mention, every time you go there, they're so good at being like 2 weeks ahead of what you're going to need. And you just see it and you're like, oh my God, look at these incredible life jackets. Like, these things are usually $125 if you go to like anywhere near a lake, and they're freaking $39.99. Like, I gotta have one
just cuz.
Yeah. I'm gonna walk around my house that I don't have a pond or a lake within freaking 30 miles of me. I'm just gonna walk around my house with this life jacket on.
I'm a good fucking swimmer, but I want this fucking life jacket.
It just feels good. It feels like a bulletproof vest.
Yeah,
I'm gonna put it on under my shirt. No, but going back to it, they have three. How much? If you go to CVS, what do you buy? How much is Zyrtec,
dude? I don't
know. Or Allegra or whatever.
I think I bought mine from like a Mapco in fucking Eastern Tennessee.
I think you're getting 30 pills for $30. That's what I think you're doing.
That might be the case.
Costco. It's Kirkland brand, 365 pills. I got allergy pills until I'm 40, and it was $11.99.
You're set for the next four seasons.
That's the problem. Like, you put it in the cart, it's $12, so it jacks up your bill. But I'm good on friggin' allergy for. I mean, literally, my kids will be all right with allergies.
Dude, send some of that shit down here. You're getting, you're stocking up. Send it down here, man. I want to try this Kirkland.
365 pills. I'm like, how does that many fit in this jar? It's not even that big.
You know what's funny? Kirkland? Where are they located? Where's Kirkland at? I never see a Kirkland store or a Kirkland plant. Where's Kirkland?
Well, it's
there's
funny.
So much stuff that comes from Kirkland.
It's funny you mention that.
Where's Kirkland?
It's not a store, man. It's funny you mention that, because actually Kirkland is a store. I don't know how this happens. No, but it's not related. Kirkland is like a freaking like a furniture store, and it's outrageously expensive. It's like Pottery Barn, but on steroids.
Gotta love some Pottery Barn.
But Kirkland is, dude, it's Costco's brand, man. They don't That's the store. Costco is the store for Kirkland. You know?
I know, but Kirkland is like Amazon. The shit's taken over. Like, you make yourself a sports drink. Can you hear this lady vacuuming in the background?
Yes.
What the fuck?
No, barely, though. Barely. It's not going to interfere. It's nice.
Well, she's interfering with me in my headspace right now. That's
some nice white noise for the viewers.
God, I mean, come on, lady. She's got a backpack on. Like, I wish you could see this shit. I'm going to
I see Tommy Boy vacuuming moss. I mean,
can you not? We're going to put one of these clips on the podcast.
Not Tommy Boy.
I got to get this on camera. It looks like she's going scuba diving with this fucking vacuum. There's a tank on her back could fit
Richard.
A couple small children.
Richard's vacuuming the moss.
Richard. But anyway, I mean,
some cold coffee. Yuck.
Yuck.
It's been 36 minutes since we started.
When does cold coffee become iced coffee?
When you put ice cubes in it.
Do you drink iced coffee ever?
Yeah, summertime.
So
on a day like this. It's like 85 degrees outside.
Yeah. Like, do you put anything in it? How do you take it? Does iced coffee make you shit?
Not really.
Some would argue yes. Some would argue no. Because some would argue that the poop comes from the warmth in your tummy.
That's what I would agree.
I know you would. I heard that many times before. It's not the coffee. It's the warm water that's going down into your tummy.
Well, I mean, like, the coffee bean has,
bean flicker in it?
Bean flicker fiber in it that friggin' ignites
definitely
your system.
Gets down into that stomach and gives it a little.
I've kind of experimented with this, like, in the morning with some lemon water. You know, because I heard that was good for you, and sometimes, you know,
I've been drinking a lot of lemon water lately. We can talk about that in a minute.
Is it warm or cold?
Cold. Fuck that.
Oh. Well, either one's
water
good,
but lemon shit.
Well, nighttime, dude, I'm telling you, it's supposed to be really good for you.
Yeah.
Grandma taught me this. I tried that. It didn't have its. It worked, but not like full power, maybe like 50 to 70% power.
Wait, what worked? Lemon coffee?
Yes. No, not lemon coffee, lemon water. Warm lemon water. So I confirmed my theory with the warm thing, you know, igniting the system in the morning, but it wasn't full 100% power. It was like 50 to 70%.
Oh, so you only emptied. You didn't really empty the tank. You didn't really get the full effect of the.
No. It was like you had to revisit. You had to, revisit like maybe 20, 30 minutes later.
Chair number one.
Yeah.
So getting back to it, does iced coffee make you poop?
No.
No. You could drink that all day. And you could run a marathon.
I mean,
and you won't shit your drawers.
Might make some people poop. Doesn't make me. But you know, this, you know, it's just not I can't think of it. The portions of the experiment here, the variables, the frickin' variables of the experiment are probably not consistent here, because normally if I drink iced coffee, it's normally like in the middle, like noon, 2 o'clock.
You get that little pick me up going in the afternoon.
Yeah, and it's hot outside, and you're like, I want something to pick me up, but I can't be drinking hot coffee right now.
That little afternoon Zamboni.
I'm not saying I wouldn't drink it in the morning. It just don't, you know, when you got like the Keurig or whatever, it's, I don't think you're just, I mean, I don't even know what you do. Just make a Keurig cup of coffee and then throw some cubes in it. Maybe
it depends on what kind of maker you got. I got one of them Ninjas. It's got a button on there.
For iced coffee?
Iced button. It's not heating it up. It's just distilling it through the system and then it's pouring it over ice.
Wow.
And when you get that, I mean, it's some kind of special, I'll tell you that.
Wow.
You can make personal cups. You can make a full batch. And you ice that thing down. See, you know, call me crazy, but I put a little almond milk in mine, just a little splash, give it a little color so you can't see through it. Just a little splash so you can't see through it. And that makes me happy. I drink my coffee black, personally. It's just a thing I've been doing for, well, pretty much ever since I started drinking coffee. I don't need any of that sugary pumpkin latte fucking ice cream whippy flappy wappy frappuccino bullshit in my coffee. I don't need
If you're putting almond milk in there, it sure doesn't sound like you're drinking it black.
Dude, that's the iced coffee version. The hot version is black.
Oh, okay.
Black. Okay. You know, that way, and somebody's got coffee, you don't even have to say, hey, you got any cream? Hey, you got any sugar? Can I have some cream and sugar with my coffee? Because normally I like to have some cream and sugar. No, you just fucking drink it. Let that thing turbo blast you.
Yeah, you can't, don't be in the driver's seat when you go through Starbucks drive-thru and you got to order for your woman. Cause
no.
You'll be like, it's like trying to interpret like Otani, you know, on the friggin' Washington Nationals or something.
Nah, yeah, you can't, I just say anytime, anymore, I just say, I'm driving, I'm going to pull up to the window, talk loud, and order it yourself, because yeah. I'm not doing this half scoop of fucking sugar cream,
four pumps
of chocolate ass cream.
Something, did I hear a coconut shrimp in there? Like, did you say coconut shrimp
they got in shrimp your coffee? At Starbucks.
My God.
You guys are going seafood on us?
I don't even know what kind of POS system does Starbucks have where they can even punch that in? Like, dude, is there like a friggin' pump button where they're like 1, 2, 3, 4, like they said 4 pumps, pump, 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 pump,
four,
pump.
Four and a half pumps.
Four and a half pumps of
Mocha Jave.
Of fat-free,
linear.
Fat-free, sugar-free, freaking
linear caramel milk. It's horse shit. And don't put any whipped cream on top. Oh, because the whipped cream's going to be the bad for you part. For sure.
God, you got coconut shrimp in your freaking coffee. What do you, you don't want some Cool Whip on that thing?
Yeah, dilute that
My
fucking
God.
Scampi taste?
My Jesus.
Holy would you like some cocktail sauce with the side of your frappuccino?
Would you like some cocktail sauce around the rim?
Now we're getting deer tay, and it's getting out of control.
Goodness gracious.
Yeah, you can't be doing that. That's why it's just easy. It's easier for, I mean, just drink it black, and then you just, like, but you go to, like, for me, like, if I ever, I don't really ever go to Starbucks unless, like, yeah.
You got a gift card?
Yeah. but when I do go there, you know, it's like a $5 black coffee, and I don't even know how to order it. I'm just like, I want to.
You want it small, but somehow it's tall.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
All their names are like Spanish and Italian, and they all mean tall or large, but somehow it's small. Like,
right.
Grande, freaking.
Grande, grunde.
I don't even know.
Venti. Can I get a venti? What's a venti?
I'm pretty sure that doesn't even mean what it means at Starbucks.
No. But I just feel weird ordering it, and then the people judge me. I know they judge me. They're like, why aren't you getting four and a half pumps of this? Why aren't you pumping it up with some of the freaking cocktail sauce? You don't want rimmed cocktail sauce on your shit? No. I want a black fucking coffee.
You want some, you want to try our new seasonal coconut shrimp, fat-free, freaking caramel mochiata Charlie Cold Foam latte? If you can say it correctly, we'll give it to you for free.
Yeah, right. They're going to come out. They're going to pick you up. turn you upside down and they're just going to shake your pockets. If you want anything that says Charlie in it, it's going to cost you.
Yeah, I'll have a venti mocha carmiato Charlie whippy frappy with two pumps of caramel mochi something and another half pump of sugar-free almond butter brittle batter crispies.
One wipe Charlie.
That'll be $19.50.
That'll be $19.50. You know, you really added on to your cost with the extra four pumps. It's like three bucks a pump.
My goodness.
Margins are high.
And then you know the best part? They don't even finish it.
No, not even close. Fucking and half bullshit. Of it's filled with fucking ice if it's a cold foam.
Or foam. Or just literal foam.
Frick.
Gosh. Okay, here goes this freaking vacuum lady again.
More moss.
She's getting the moss off the windowsills out there. The windowsills. Hallelujah. Amen.
Who's that, Morgan?
Yeah, Morgan and Hardy.
Morgan and Hardy. You know,
you listen to Hardy at all?
Yeah, I do. I listen to Hardy. Yeah,
I like that dude.
He's good. Yeah, and his songs with Morgan are good.
Yeah,
are real good. You know, talk about killing the freaking Billboard game, freaking Morgan. I think
he's dancing on all these fools,
dude. The top 50, if you go on the charts on iTunes, I think 36 of them are Morgan Wallen songs, and he's got 36 songs on his new album, and that's
36,
literally out of control.
36. He just came out with an album last year.
But that's what you have to
20 something songs on
it. That's what you have to do in today's age. You can't. I'm sorry. It doesn't matter who it is. I know we're on the topic of country right now, but I love Eric Church. I love Eric Church. But you can't come out with an album every 2 years. You're done, dude. No one's talking about you anymore.
But, Eric Church kind of did his thing. Like,
yeah, I understand.
He's coasting now.
Yeah, but why?
I don't know.
That everything I read about that dude, he's got like hundreds of songs that he's written, you know, just lined up. Like, why are you not releasing? Like, Morgan's not like, oh, well, let's not pick the best 12. Release them all. But with how accessible music is these days, everyone's listening to them all. And yeah, you get on like three or four songs that you love and you're jiving with for like a week. And then you friggin' wear them babies out. So then you start listening to like three or four other songs on the album. And then you get hooked on those, and then you wear those out. But if you have an 11-song album, your shit's over and done with in a week.
Yeah, you can't
we're
get
done with your shit.
That's like driving to Chipotle for a burrito, and you're done. Album's over.
It's old news. Old news, and then, yeah, your burrito sucked. So
you're already fucking pissed.
You're already pissed.
Music's over and your burrito sucks. What a shitty day.
He's killing the game. And not to change subjects, but gosh damn it, Chipotle. You had me going at least once a week, maybe fucking twice a week to get
going to get him fired up.
To get the best. My camera was off. You had me going once, maybe twice a week to get the greatest food on the planet. I mean, every time I ate one, I would eat it. I could eat it back-to-back days, and on the second day, I'm like, that was freaking amazing. Like, that was such a good burrito. I want to go back again. I'd go back for dinner. And you lost it. Quality control, everything just went out the window, and that was it. I mean,
It starts with the employees, the burrito makers. You go in there, and it looks like a fucking tornado came in And took all the toppings and all the meats and all the salsas and just blended them up and threw them all over the fucking restaurant.
Seriously.
Like, they're on the glass. They're on the fucking counter. Where and you know, your burrito is making a wake when they pull it across the counter to get it made down to the other side. Like, you're sweeping other people's burritos and bowls while you're going down the line.
You got hot salsa in your burrito and you didn't even order it.
Because it's on the outside of your burrito.
Because it's stuck to the freaking chicken.
It's horse shit.
But my goodness, it does start with the employees, but that starts with the top. I mean, whatever their franchise model is, the quality control is not a priority. It's not. And it makes me so mad because I'll give them the benefit of the doubt when I say this. One out of five, probably, burritos that you get now are good. And and they're so good that the one out of five literally keeps me still occasionally going.
Yeah.
And that pisses me off to say.
Dude, but the other thing is, now you go in there, you get your burrito, and you're walking out of there. It's 11, 12 bucks. You could go in there with a five. When I remember in high school, when Chipotle first got invented, you could go into fucking Chipotle with a $5 bill. And then they upped it to $5.25. You could get a burrito. You could hand them a $5 bill. You could eat. You could stuff your face. You could get all full and happy. And you could walk out of there $5.
And you almost couldn't finish. Like, the people that finished the burritos
gargantuans.
Back in the day, you were like, this dude is a beast or woman. They can just pound. Like, but now, literally almost every time I go there, I'm like, yo, can you put some rice on my burrito?
Is this your rice? Is like, it your rice?
I didn't order
for the rice.
I didn't order a fucking chimichanga. I want a Chipotle burrito.
Like, it is horse shit. It's double. You feel like it's double wrapped, and that's just because, I mean, it's kind of double, like, it's double wrapping itself.
Exactly.
Fucking
exactly.
Bullshit.
Oh my God.
It's not cold out here, ladies and gentlemen. We don't want two layers on. We want that burrito. We want the tortilla to be so stretched that there's a piece of chicken just poking out, and he's like, got his face pressed up against the glass, and you could see every part of his face, and he's just ready, like, one little squeeze of that burrito, and that little chicken piece is coming out of there hot and heavy, just boom!
Sometimes they take, like, the spoon slap, and they, like, slap it on top of the burrito, and literally, like, 30% of your chicken flies off the friggin' foil, which is, to your credit, what happens when it just gets everywhere.
The next person gets part of your chicken.
Three pieces of my chicken went in the sour cream thing, and they friggin' sank to the bottom.
God knows. They're done. R.I.P.
My goodness. Friggin' drowning soldiers in there.
It's ridiculous.
Sometimes, like, I literally, probably two or three of the last 10 burritos that I've gotten, the rice hasn't been cooked all the way. It's like I'm biting gravel in my friggin' burrito.
That's unacceptable.
I want to go back and just crow hop this thing into the freaking fridge right behind the register and let it just explode all over the freaking Coronas and little margarita things they got in there.
And then yell, cook the fucking rice.
Gosh damn.
Dude, how do you
And you're out of freaking vinaigrette? Like,
how do you not cook the rice all the way through? And that's not good for you either, because that rice is expanding no matter what. I don't care what you say. There's liquids down in your tummy that are getting into that rice, and that rice, you're eating that rice, and it's getting bigger down there. It's expanding in your stomach. I'm just good. This is what's happening.
It's a mess waiting to happen. And then I'm like, okay, can I get a vinaigrette? Oh, we're out of vinaigrette. No. I can literally see them in the fridge right behind you, and they like turn around. They're like, oh, that's not vinaigrette. I'm like, it's vinaigrette. I can see it, but just give me the freaking burrito.
And it's 4 p.m. How are you out of vinaigrette? That's one of the, you have a salad.
Chicken.
You have a salad on the fucking menu.
Or chicken. I've gone in there. I'm sorry. You close at 10 p.m. I've gone in there at like 7:30, 8 o'clock, and they're like, "Yeah, we're out of chicken." They're not out of chicken. They just don't want to cook anymore.
Dude, but then I've gone into other ones at like 9:30, and they got a full thing of chicken, and the grill is filled with fucking chicken. I'm like, hold on a second.
They're probably making it for tomorrow.
Who's orchestrating this here? Because this makes no fucking sense.
Gosh damn it, Chipotle!
You got to find a good one.
Here's part of the reason McDonald's owns them.
So it's already
they're like McDonald's is they're around every corner now, pretty much. And I think that's where it all got lost. Because when back in the day, there was like one Chipotle in every square 100 miles, and the focus was concentrated focus. They're trying to get their name out there, and the quality control was up to par. And then I think when McDonald's bought them, which is surprising because McDonald's, for the most part, has mastered their
and
what they're good at. It's like, why
can't
you? I
feel like they're revamping a lot of their locations to be like new futuristic McDonald's. You could order on the screen, and you could, you know, something comes in, you go into the bathroom, and something wipes your ass for you. And it's all futuristic. There's like four people working in there now. Nobody's flipping burgers.
Kiosks.
There's an Elon Musk AI robot back there just like, burgers squirt. Flipping like crazy. Squirt. Mayo. Mustard. Ketchup. Pickles. Cheese.
Send it.
Wrap it up. Perfect.
Yeah, they need to do that shit with the burritos. But, you know, I go back to it. You go into a... The funny thing is, like, you kind of know your Chipotles now. You know which ones...
Now you better
be clean and don't. But man, when you get a good one, it is so good.
It is good. And it makes you feel good too. But like some of the bad ones make you not feel good. Like you're holding your tummy and you're running to the old Johnny Hancock, locking yourself in the old
You're doing the old handspring. Handspring out of the Johnny Hancock.
You're getting into that porcelain bus driver area, and you're just holding onto the walls. Grabbing onto whatever you can grip, and just, you're like, oh, God.
Giving the old John Hancock the hairy dun.
Oh, boy.
Goodness gracious.
That's some crazy shit. From buck names to...
Quite literally.
From buck names to blowing out some Chipotle. Cleaning the pipes.
Hey. We the people.
Oh, my goodness. At least... Yeah, I don't know. I don't fucking know.
Well, it's Friday, folks. Well, for us, sorry. I keep forgetting. Shit.
It's so weird because we're recording it. Like, do we let people know that, or do we just say, you know, no, this is Wednesday. This is Wednesday.
Well.
I guess they know now, so.
I guess they know. I already.
Cat's out of the bag.
That up. Cat's out of the bag, people. It's Friday.
It's Friday. We're not launching this for like 3 days.
TGIF. Have a blessed Wednesday.
Have a blessed Wednesday. Have a blessed hump day. Make this week or the rest of this week your biatch.
Yeah.
But yeah, we probably got to get rolling. We got a meeting here shortly. Some big stuff. Hopefully some big stuff coming down the pipe, which is great.
Which is great. And when y'all are listening to this, we'll be a couple days away from joining forces at Camp Cutlet.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We're about a little over a week away. Uncle Jay's coming up. I'm coming up. Hopefully Dad will be there. I don't know who else is going to be there, but we're going to be yip-yapping at some New York long stockings and hoping to roll some heads.
And then noodling catfish in the pond in the afternoon.
We got Hannah Barron coming up, and Jeff, they're going to help us noodle the pond out.
We got some mammoths in the pond we got to take care of. Throw them babies on the grill.
Get bit, baby. Hashtag it.
Hashtag appreciate y'all.
I love them people.
I do too. Great. Just so authentic and you just can't beat it.
And you know what is cool about both of them? Like, we've known Hannah for probably, I don't know,
a long time.
6-8 years at least.
Yeah.
And I mean, really, Jeff the same. And
Uncle Jeff.
Uncle Jeff. And they're always so happy to see you.
They're so happy to see you. They give you a yes.
They just give you a great warm feeling. And
yeah,
we need more of that. We need more of that. Like, there's no ego involved in either of them. And it's refreshing to be around. It makes me want to stick my hand in a catfish's mouth. And I don't like open water, really. So
that's... No, it is. You're right, though. They do. Yeah. They just give you that vibe. They don't care. They don't care what the, you know, yeah, like you said, egos are out of it. It just, they just love doing what they're doing, living the lifestyle. And
yeah. It ain't about the follower count. It ain't about the.
They are true to it.
Yeah. Yep. Good people.
And Uncle Jeff will build you a house and fucking.
Holy shit. Have you been following along?
It's insane. I want him to build me a house, honestly.
And the houses are freaking amazing. Well, and Hannah's building that thing too.
I know. I'm impressed.
It is pretty awesome.
Extremely impressed.
Hey, God bless.
Hey, God bless.
Well, that's probably a good place to cut it off for the day. TGIF, but TGIW for all you listening right now. And I mean, you know, you don't know. They could, you know, you could be listening on a Friday.
You could be
listening on a Thursday, Saturday. I mean, you might be taking this in weeks down the road, and we appreciate it all. Like, honestly, from the bottom of my ticker, you know, we appreciate everybody that listens and gives us feedback and follows along on a week-to-week basis. As we always say, y'all are making the dream come true. So that's good shit.
It's true.
It's good shit. Well, any last parting words, Dina?
You know, not really. Just make sure Chipotle cooks your rice.
And hey. God, name your bucks. Like, get creative, okay? Get creative with your buck names.
Have some fun. Loosen up the G-string. Loosen up that cheese cutter in your crack. And friggin' just, I don't care what you're doing. Just enjoy it a little bit.
Enjoy
just don't take it so seriously. Don't be like... Don't make everything like a competition within yourself or with somebody. Just
have some fun.
Just be in the moment and have some fun.
Hey, smile. It makes everyone around you feel better. Just smile.
If you have to, if your freaking undershorts, like if you can't loosen them enough, then just take them off and go commando.
There's nothing wrong with that either.
No, you might feel differently throughout the day.
I couldn't agree more. Weights I don't have pants on right now.
Thank God this is a friggin' shoulders up only podcast.
Yeah, because I ain't got any fucking pants on.
Because it's warm in here.
My cheese cutter was cutting my cheese too much. Cheese was cut. The cheese was cut. And I don't have any more crackers.
I freaking snapped my cheese cutter in half.
It's
in the garbage.
I gotta go to Costco and get a Kirkland brand. Yeah. It'll last forever.
Oh shit!
Oh man, we brought that one full circle. I'll tell you,
full circle. So yeah, loosen up that cheese cutter and don't order your woman's coffee from Starbucks.
And name your next buck Bruce.
Have some fun in this world, and those are your four lovely lessons for today.
God bless, people.
God bless. It's been real.
We'll see you next Wednesday.